let's move in to what is arguably one of the most powerful marketing tools in your arsenal. It's known by lots of other names. Strategic alliances, cooperative marketing, fusion marketing, partnership marketing, right? I mean, some of you already have these partnerships. Richard, do you have any partnerships, either formal or informal, with the people who send you business? Let's just say, I bet, contractors, builders?
Of course.
Right, of course. Did you have your go-to, the builders, that you're their go-to guy?
Of course.
All the time?
Yeah.
Right, so that's a referral marketing relationship. Let's suppose that you just have one of those, but there are 10 builders that you'd like to cultivate that relationship with. Right away, limiting beliefs. One says, they've already got, I'm sure they already have electricians that they do business with. In fact, I remember from session one you saying that.
Yeah.
Bank. CVS and Sovereign Bank. Huh? Pharmacy and large regional bank. Anybody going to CVS recently?
They have bank machines in there?
Yeah, they have ATM machines in there. Now, you might argue with me, well, these are probably not true fusion marketing because there are real estate plays that were arranged at the highest levels of the corporation where there's some exchange of money. Maybe. Maybe not. What I see is a smart marketer at either Sovereign Bank or at CVS. We don't know who initiated that, but let's just pick one. I'm the banker. And I say, you know what? Real estate is super expensive. I cannot compete with all the local banks, and I'm trying to get penetration in these territories, and it's going to be ridiculously expensive for me to go and buy kiosk space on every little road stand. Ah! Where are their big retail presence? Where's a big retail presence? CVS. Now, CVS spends lots of money on advertising. If I know that and I say, you know what, I can go, John, and I'm sorry I called you Joe earlier, and you're the CEO of CVS or the chief marketing officer at CVS, and I say, I've got a proposition for you that might be mutually beneficial to our businesses. You have lots of traffic and captive ad space for me. If I put a little Sovereign Bank ATM kiosk in there, all you people are coming through seeing it. At the same time, I'm willing to defray some of the cost of your billboard advertising. And if you drive around now, you'll periodically see a billboard that's both CVS and Sovereign Bank. That's an example of an unconventional match, one that you wouldn't necessarily think of. But there's a reasonable trade that exists there. And I don't know the details of the trade, and it's not important for our exercise. I'm just trying to get you thinking big. And if you're the electrician, you don't necessarily have to just be thinking about builders. Okay, then we can explore what else you may think of. What's another one? United Postal Service and Find the Cure. What's that partnership? Anybody know? When's the last time?
The cancer.
Yeah, the cancer. This campaign has been replaced, that ribbon campaign. But for many years, you walk into any post office and you saw huge cardboard displays. In fact, there was even a stamp series that went out.
Right.
Right? Do you think the U.S. Postal Service, however that chain of command, that bureaucracy works, says, I think we need a new stamp, and I think I'll just use Find the Cure. That was some relationship that was negotiated at the highest levels of those two organizations. But there was there was great thought about how can me, as the cancer Find the Cure chairman, get broader exposure to not hundreds or thousands, but millions of people across all the post offices in the United States. And it didn't start with the stamp. It started with posters that were driving traffic to the Find the Cure website. They were trying to build awareness about this campaign and get people contributing directly. It was pure donation, charitable contribution play that evolved into this long-term strategic partnership. Same with the Boston Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund. Everybody, I haven't been into a baseball game in a while, but I remember one time the announcer came on. They had a little Johnny at the front, from a microphone talking about he was a patient at Children's Hospital in Boston, told his little story. Next thing I know, I have all these workers from the stands passing little baseball cups, little cans, Jimmy Fund cans, contributing to the Jimmy Fund. Talk about a captive audience, right? 50,000 fans who just heard a little compelling story from Johnny. They see him on the Jumbotron, and next thing you know, they're passing cans. Why do I tell you this?
Yeah.
I tipped my hat already.
Yeah.
I mean, just think about what that was. Okay, so I'm Killington, and I need more bodies coming to my resort. Am I happy to give $10 away? Because I know most of my money is made not on the lift ticket, but on the concessions. And I know that most people don't ski alone. Right? So I'm just going to blanket the world with these $10 off coupons. And the best place to do it is at these pump, and they all have these little pump displays, right? And they have little tear-off coupons. So I'm getting advertising right then and there, but I'm also getting a traffic-generating resource, that coupon. And what's mobile doing? What's mobile get out of all this? Why am I giving you, American Skiing Company, all this free advertising space? Because guys like me are going out of their way to go to your gas station. Exactly. Okay, so that should get you thinking big about the possibilities. So let's jump in to what I'm going to do now is I'm going to fly over these, and that way we can reserve the time to detailed exploration when we split into groups. So I'm going to introduce these steps to building your Fusion marketing plan. All right, what's the first thing you need to do? Figure out what you want to do. Exactly. Set your intention. And that takes, again, the brainstorming exercise. Okay, what is it that I'm looking for? Is it more, you know, this website thing? I really would like some internet partners. I'm looking for more, I need my phone to ring more already. I need to begin to extend my reach into a new marketplace. I need to start to position myself in this niche. I mean, the electrician, that's a great one. Like, you specialize in people with an eco-consciousness and perhaps these solar installations. So what's the purpose of this Fusion marketing? Right here, this all, by the way, this nitty-gritty begins on page 12. There's lots of things. Is it an event that you'd like to promote? Nessie, yes, for you it is. Green and Greenfield, yes, for them it is, right? Their 10% challenge. Is it a one-time occurrence? Just as a joint promotion for this special event? Maybe it's an ongoing event. Maybe it's building a mailing list campaign that you want to do, right? So that's the very first step. And then I ask you to think a little bit deeper. This is still step one. So the step one is set the intention. Step two, 1A, is set a deeper intention. How would you characterize the people or product how would you characterize people or products that you refer? What are the sorts of qualities that you look for? Well, you look for quality. That's certainly one of them. That trustworthiness, that reliability, right? I mean, if you're going to partner with someone, you're going to have some criteria, some standards that you're going to hold them to, are you not? I mean, you don't want to find a partner whose website looks schlocky or whose manner is suspect or who isn't very good at their follow-through, right? Yeah, obviously. Why do I say that? You got to give what you get. Yeah. And if you want to get someone who's reliable, who's trustworthy, who's high quality, who's competent and capable, you have to be those things. Oh, well, of course I am those things. I'm always those things. Are you? Are you? Maybe you think you are, but does your marketing material reflect that? Do your customers think that? Do you have the testimonials to support that? So part of the deeper intention goes to, let me look at my own house first and make sure my house is in order. Make sure I am those things and I deliver those things that I expect of the partners that I'm approaching. This goes back to that look in the mirror. Remember, session one, I said my favorite tool in the guerrilla marketing toolbox is a mirror, so you can stare at it and look at the habits that serve you and those that don't. Here's another opportunity for you to do that. All right, step two, pick your power partners. I just gave you an exercise where I said, look, CVSX, it wasn't an exercise so much as a lecturette, CVS and Sovereign Bank, not a whole lot of obvious synergies right there, right? Ski resorts and gas companies, not an obvious synergy there either. Nonprofit organization, cancer research organization, and the United States Postal Service. So when we think Fusion and the examples that roll off my tongue and that rolled off Dan's tongue, you know, electrician and the builder, the planner and the designer and the subcontractors, the solar store and the who? It's another likely partner. Obviously. How about builders? Building companies, contractors, right? The larger ones. Right. So some are obvious, but some aren't so obvious. So let's think about your partnership. Who right now could, if
you know, given a low pressure environment, could think of at least half a dozen potential partnerships, high gain potential partnerships that you'd like to pursue. So that's a yes. Let me ask it this way. How many people does that feel like a struggle? It's like, God, I don't really know who I could partner with. One, Nancy. Okay, so you don't really need this exercise that much. Pick your power partners. I start to give you some cues. Who's your child scout leader? Who's in the Rotary Club? So this might not help. Let me back up. It's not so much thinking about the type of business, but some introduction to that business. I think that if you have just a little bit of quiet and thinking, you should be able to come up with half a dozen businesses that touch the same type of customers that you want to touch. Isn't that what it's ultimately about? If you're trying to extend your reach, it's not to everybody, it's to a very particular target market. Ha! There's that word again. Traffic. Who? So who else touches those people? And this exercise here, when I says who's in your PTO, who sells you, who cuts your hair, who's your chiropractor, who are your friends from college and school, that goes to finding a connection at that organization. It's like, God, I really would like to hook up with a couple of the major contracting companies in the Valley, but I only know one of them at Wright Builders. I'd like to know that guy from Renaissance, and I'd like to know that guy from Zachary, and I'd like to know, right, on and on and on. Start to go through this list, and connections almost inevitably emerge, and it becomes easy to get those introductions. It's sort of like the personal LinkedIn. You with me? All right, so picking the power partners. Of course, based on number one, what's the intention that you have? Step three, approach and plant a seed. This is hard for a lot of people, and why I begin this exercise with that attempt to help you transcend your limiting beliefs. Because if you don't have a deep network and you don't have a personal introduction, guess what has to happen? You got to do it yourself. Exactly. You got to do it yourself. And that's often where people shut down in this process, because I have to make a cold call. It feels like a cold call. But that's all mental chatter that's slowing you down. You could put together a nice letter, and it's not a cold call where you're trying to sell something. It's an approach to plant a seed about a potential partnership, because fusion partnership is about a win-win. It's not a you give me. It's a I give you, you give me. It's a quid pro quo. All right? And very often the exchange isn't direct. It doesn't have to be a dollar for dollar exchange. We're going to explore that next in the subsequent steps. Okay, so you're tracking with me now? All right, so you approach and plant a seed. There's an exercise in here that helps you do what I continually remind you to do, which is distill your language down to its essence. So imagine that you're approaching this person and you get their voicemail. What will you say in 30 seconds to get them to say, God, you know, Dan, that was a great, I'm really curious. What is he talking about? I'd like to explore that further. If you can't do it in the 30-second voice, if you can't do it right now in writing, and you don't have a direct introduction to a friendly person who will listen to you sort of babble on about it, then you've got to do this, because it's going to be someone who's a stranger to you. You kind of need your elevator pitch. All that work from last week will support step three. Step four, this is where you get to think big and selfishly. Ask for what you want. And I also began this by reminding you of ways to think big. Same with the ask for what you want. Because we have to talk about what you give as well as what you get. And it's always more fun to think about what you can get from someone. Maybe not. But what are the things that you want? Going back to step one, what's the intention? It's to build my list. For Jenny, it's to sell booth space. So once you do give a lot of thought and consideration to the target market and the partners who might potentially reach that market, what you want are what? Repeated mentions in their newsletters? Shared space in their advertising, an insert in their direct mail piece, a regular column in their e-zine. I mean, if I'm a retail storefront, what I want is coupons at the point of purchase, right? I mean, you move away the Chiclets and the Trident from the cash register and you put a buy one, get one free offer from your local whomever, whatever. So there might be some sort of couponing exchange. This is where it can get really fun to think about what you can give and get, and what we'll go into detail very shortly. All right, ask for what you want. A little bit about a promotional tip, we'll do that in small group. As a salesman, one of my favorite adages is, the fortune's in the follow-up. The fortune's in the follow-up. So whatever campaign you build, make sure you're building in some mechanism for follow-up. And that follow-up goes not only to the campaign, that is, the customers who are going to respond to your special offer, who are going to pick up the phone and call you, who are going to email you for more information, but following up with the partner. I mean, I use the words cultivate relationship very specifically, because cultivation doesn't mean you go and plant a seed and then walk away. It means there's steady attention to it. Now, that may be weekly, it may be monthly, it may be quarterly. Yeah. But let's suppose that for who's got the expensive product? Who's got a long buying cycle here?
If you're cleaning chimneys, you probably only have to hit them once a year, right?
Yeah, but I would say to the two people that are hoping would chime in the very back of the room, Claire even said as much on day one, it's a very long buying cycle. From the moment people think about putting solar panels on the roof to the moment they actually do, it could be a year, right? So what happens if I only communicate with you once a year? Meantime, Altaris and PV Squared and all the other people have come in at the time when I was ready to move along in my buying process. But if I come to your store on the first time and I opt into your list because you asked me to, because you're going to do that now that Dan suggested it, and you're building the most valuable asset you can have as a business, which is what? Your customer database. Exactly. Because you're building that. Now you say, okay, great, what we'd like to do with you, Mr. Prospect, Ms. Customer, is we periodically send important pieces of information, news, insights, useful content, however you characterize it, to people who are considering a solar panel installation. Exactly. So all you have to do now is, actually you couldn't write their name and put it in the list. Like, I can't add names to my list, you actually have to opt in. You know that one shopping cart? I can't go and put you in. I suppose I could, I have to send you a message, but then you have to reply back and verify. Right, it's an anti-spam measure. And so there, in their instance, I would say once a year isn't enough. Once a quarter, as much as you can keep up with, it's hard to do a monthly commitment. Certainly weekly is too much. Then you go into Richard's spam folder. Right?
That's right.
Okay. So those are the steps. Those are the steps that we go through in cultivating a fusion marketing partner. And I would maintain that the most difficult ones are approaching the partner. Once you do the thinking about, God, I really would like to connect with.
So you're a consultant, an energy efficient consultant. You could do an audit to help me decide what
I
it's
going to do. I don't do the audit, but I certainly want to be a facilitator to be able to put them in touch.
Okay, so we have to talk about how you position yourself. So right away, what I'm saying is, I definitely want you in my group. We can take all the work that we've done in the prior sessions
to surmount this first. What I said is probably the hardest thing about that, which is the approach. So what is it that you're going to say to me once you figure all this out? You have to call the loaner. You have to call someone at the bank. And you have to think about, okay, what's the offer to the bank? Why would the bank want to give me this time? What would I want to make you my go-to resource for this? And I could see doing that. I'll bet you, if you ask polled mortgage originators right now, local lenders, I bet there's a lot, if you ask them, how often do you get requests for loan or requests for information about financing for solar installation projects? I'll bet you all of them say, you know what, it's rising more and more, right? I mean, I'm sure of it.
Can I just throw out a couple of examples of local fusion marketing that maybe...
Yes, by all means. Please.
Some of the whole room has benefit of hearing this.
Thank you.
One is Mesa Verde, the restaurant that's right next door to us. They do a lot of radio spots, and I've heard Amy, who does the spots, do a lot of mentioning the local restaurants in Greenfield. I love Greenfield. I like going to the, I don't remember the places that she's mentioned, maybe.
Hope and Olive.
Going to the Pint, going to Hope and Olive, doing this. You know, there's so many great places in Greenfield to eat. She's done a very, very good job with that. And she approached Claire the other day, and she said something about, oh, you should do a spot. And I think what she was trying to do with that, and we haven't explored it any further yet, but I think she was trying to, hey, you know, the solar store can say, you know, we love this place, we eat there all the time because we're next door. We even ate there before we, you know, were next door to them. Where we get time on their spot and they get, you know, a plug from us. I believe this is what she was looking for, is that Mesa Verde pays for the airtime. Greenfield Solar Store comes on and says, hey, we're the Greenfield Solar Store, and we eat at Mesa Verde all the time because they're great.
Gotcha.
Which they are.
Oh, when you mentioned Mesa Verde, then you started saying that people are mentioning other restaurants. I'm like, why would Mesa Verde pay for
Mesa you? Verde pays for airtime and mentions other restaurants.
It does.
So what's the advantage of that?
To show the vitality of Greenfield, especially for people outside the area, they're going, why would we go to eat in Greenfield? So to show that there are these other kinds of spots, and they're not necessarily competitive. Hope and Olive is
totally
at a
different
and the Pint are different than totally Mesa Verde.
Okay, great. Another example?
So there's another restaurant who wants one of our pellet stoves, but she can't really afford to pay for it. So we said to her, we'll put one of our demo stoves in your store. You have to pay for the installation and the pellets to keep it running, but put a sign up there and say where you got it from.
Donated. What's your kind of store?
It's another restaurant.
Okay, so here's an example of thinking big. So you're feeling that's a good exchange. You pay for the installation, you get a store, and now there's a sign next to that.
Yeah. No, they are paying for the installation.
Yeah, and then there's a sign next to the store that says this store.
No, next to the stove.
Next to the stove that says.
Right, we got it from the solar store.
We got
and
this.
They'll, you know, blah, blah, blah.
And you write it off as an advertising expense.
Okay, is that the end of the fusion marketing relationship?
No.
Well, so far, got any good ideas?
Yeah, I do. Why isn't there like an intense month? I want a menu insert for the whole month of December, talking about the solar store and how to keep we're keeping warm now. What about December? On and on. We'll talk more.
Okay.
That's what I want you to do.
Uh-huh.
I want coupons passed to every patron that leaves.
Right,
let me
get
that's what
check.
I want.
Yeah.
All right,
coupon.
Let's go.
The idea that when I'm going to approach sponsors to help with some of our events. I really emphasize that NESI has been around for 35 years, and we do have the premier conference in the Northeast. Mm-hmm. Really be committed to showing the sponsors that and, you know, entice them to partner up with us more because of that fact.
So thinking more about leveraging your marquee name, because she was talking about the need to get sponsors, not necessarily for the big annual conference, but some of the other events that you do.
Green
the
Buildings
ongoing,
Open House, right?
The what Open House?
Green Buildings Open
the
House.
The Green Buildings Open House, which is another event that we don't have to bother explaining, but she needs sponsors for that. So she makes a lot of money on the annual conference, but loses a little bit on these other events, including this one. So how could I go and get a sponsor, and who are the sponsors? So you shouldn't have a problem with a list of sponsors and potential sponsors. Utility companies, gas companies, oil companies, right? The folks that would be interested in touching the retail market, but rather getting them to cough up the sponsorship dollars. So then we talked about, okay, what's the message then? Why is Sheldon always talking about message? Huh? What's the value prop? What's the language? And so one of the pieces is leveraging your brand more, the fact that you're the leader in this space. You've got cachet and name recognition. The NESI logo carries some weight, correct? That's what you mean?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, guys. Thank you for reporting out on what you're going to do differently, what action you're going to take in the next 30 days. Those of you who haven't yet opted into my site, there's a chance for you to do that. I do a free monthly teleclass. Sometimes I've had 1, 2, 3 people. I've had also 40, 50 people on these teleclass calls. But you'll get an invitation to these. I do them roughly every month. So if you opt into my list and you feel like, God, it'd be nice to get Sheldon on some small group coaching time, or even free, like the last guy. One guy on my call, I got an hour of free coaching time. He was completely psyched.
Did you send us an email with this?
You have to go to steadysales.com
and sign up.
You download your free 7 Cents Marketing Plan workbook on any page you go to, except the homepage. The homepage has a big Get Started button. Click that, and any page you'll see a chance to give me your email and your first name. All right, just opt into my list, and you'll get my periodic messages, which I hope I'm practicing what I preach, high-value, short, actionable nuggets. You can tune in or not. So, Dan, could you give us, since we all admit that you can have a crappy-looking site in WordPress just as well as you can and all the other free template-based sites that exist, how can we avoid that pitfall? Can you answer that in 30 seconds or less?
Yes, there are professionally designed themes that are free that you can install with 2 clicks of a mouse through the back end of WordPress. You go search for themes, choose the colors that you like. They give you layout and color options. It'll bring up dozens to choose from. You click install, preview, activate.
There it is. Free. I like that. Did you say free?
Free.
But you have to pay $9.
You have to pay for the hosting.
No.
I was a coaching client of Sheldon's years ago.
It
That's how we met.
Look at him now.
He was hugely helpful. I still think about the same. We did the same work that you guys did. But it came at a time when I actually did the work. And I was laughing when he was talking about cold calling, because we worked on those 30-second voicemail messages for quite a while. And I still have. I read those scripts today. I worked with Sheldon. I was telling him that we did the as a coach for 3 months, and we spent hours and hours on this 30-second phone call message when I get voicemail. Well, what if I don't get voicemail? I actually get somebody, which is even scarier. And it was a lot of very valuable work that I still use today.